Good evening. I'm Mohammed Jamal, resident of Pediatric Surgery Department, Ain Shams University, presenting to you a case discussion about a recent blunt isolated abdominal trauma case we managed in our department alongside and under supervision of Professor Mohammed Debeki, Professor of Pediatric Surgery, Ain Shams University, and Dr. Nader Nassif, Lecturer of Pediatric Surgery, Ain Shams University. We'll start the patient presented to us on the 28th of May, a male patient, Adam Muhammad Anas, a 13-year-old male patient presented with abdominal pain and vomiting after 3 days of isolated blunt abdominal trauma, bicycle handlebar injury at the right hypochondrium. The patient presented with fever of 2 days duration, progressive abdominal pain mainly in the right side of the abdomen, and frequent non-bilious vomiting. On examination, the patient generally was conscious, alert, oriented to time, place, and person with Glasgow Coma Scale 15. Pulse was 150 tachycardic in proportionate to fever. He was feverish or 39 degrees. Blood pressure was 110 over 60. The local abdominal examination, there was tenderness in the right side of the abdomen, abrasions and bruises on the right hypochondrium, mostly due to the handlebar blunt trauma. Investigations were done. Laboratory investigation showed a slight increase in the total leukocytic count, 15.6, a slight decrease in the sodium, 123, albumin was 3.2. Other laboratory investigations were normal. Pelvic abdominal ultrasound on admission showed a right side.
Sorry, Muhammad Jamal, these investigations were done on admission?
In the ER.
In the ER, so on admission, when the patient is coming, which is, was many days after, how many days after injury?
After 3 days.
3 days after injury, okay.
Yeah. Pelvic abdominal ultrasound showed right side perinephric mild fluid collection with right side fluid collection finally septated, extending through the psoas muscle to the pelvis, mostly organized hematoma. X-rays were done.
We'd like everybody to share with us in our first question or poll. At this moment, what is your next step in management? Would you like to go for conservative management, watching for hemoglobin drop, or would you like to repeat ultrasound? I would like or repeat ultrasound after 48 hours, or do a CT whether with or without contrast. Kindly, would like everybody to share with us. Okay, thank you very much. We had 78% CT with oral IV contrast and only 9 and 13 for conservative and CT without contrast. Actually, we did a CT with oral and IV contrast. As we all know, these handlebar injuries to the right hypochondrium, usually we suspect either a duodenal injury or a focal hepatic injury, or sometimes jejunal and sometimes pancreatic. Also, this abdominal examination denotes asymmetry of the abdominal examination. All the right side was tender, the left side wasn't. And putting into consideration that the patient is not hemodynamically stable and he is a bit toxic. And so we preferred to do CT with oral and IV contrast. And we would like to share with you all the CT with the oral and IV contrast to tell you So all of you can tell us what's your opinion about this CT.
All is okay.
Okay, no problem. We'd like to ask everybody while seeing this CT, what would you think the diagnosis or the CT findings in this CT? Is it a normal one? Enlarged pancreas, leakage of the contrast? Can you see it clearly or not? Can you see bowel injury or presence of air outside the bowel? Actually, what happened was that we saw clearly air foci present on the right side, in the right perinephric. Sorry, back please, Dr. Gamal. As we can see clearly, back, Kamara Kamani Gamal, we can see clearly there are air foci in the right perinephric hematoma. Air foci after 3 days, presence of air in this site is mostly due to bowel injury. And in this site, typically, it's mostly due to duodenal injury. And most probably, this might be second or third part. And the beginning of the third part might be a usual cause. We tried to see the leakage of the contrast. Sometimes it wasn't that evident, but sometimes we had to see it clearly. And our colleagues in the radiology department, after revising it several times, they saw it on the CT. And we had the final CT report of a presence of right perinephric multilocular fluid collection with enhancing wall and air foci. Air foci were extending along the right psoas, reaching towards the pelvis. Leakage of contrast and air foci from the posteroinferior aspect of the at the beginning of the third part, right kidney capsular laceration at the upper and mid pole without reaching pelvic LCL system. And so we had a conclusion of a perforation of the third part of the duodenum. Next, please, Dr. Gamal. We would like everybody to share with us. We have many pediatric surgeons here, whether some of our colleagues or some of our professors. How many cases of, Dr. Saada Dhapal, please, how many cases with duodenal injury do you usually deal with, either yearly, how many duodenal injuries, traumatic duodenal injuries, do you usually deal with? Okay, it seems the poll is not working now. You can write on the chat, there's no problem. So we can change the question and say how many cases of duodenal injury, the whole cases, if you're a junior staff, or if any of our professors to tell us, is it common? Do you face it a lot? Or how are things, how do you think is it going? Okay, here's the poll, it's in progress. 1 to 2 cases, no. Okay. Okay, we can end polling. Thank you, everyone. We have 4% of our audience, 5 to 10 cases, but the usual is like 60%, just deal with the 1 or 2 cases per year. And that's actually, it's really a bit of a rare thing to manage. We can go to the next slide. After doing this CT, managing the case, thinking of what to do, thinking of this patient is coming late after the duodenal injury, 3 days and after this CT and all this, so we're in a delayed diagnosis or a delayed presentation of the patient. Should we enter quickly to the OR, do an exploration, fix the duodenum, or do whatever it takes, or should we do any other thing? In the middle of all this, we had a bad surprise. It was a nightmare, actually, at the beginning, that this patient is diagnosed to be a COVID-19 positive patient, despite no symptoms. And I hope nobody of our colleagues is stuck with dealing with a corona positive case that should be explored. But I would like to ask everybody, after knowing the diagnosis, after knowing that it's a corona positive case, what would you like to do to this patient now? And I would now welcome Dr. Mohammed Debeki to continue our presentation.
Okay, thank you, Dr. Nader. So the opinion of the attendees now is going towards the exploration regardless the diagnosis with the 58%. And 17% suggested going with pigtail insertion, and 25% suggested that we start with the contrast follow-through. Okay. Exploration by far is the direct answer for the duodenal injury when we are having the free air in the retroperitoneum, which is a pathognomonic sign for duodenal injury, especially the second part. Still, at that time, the fear from COVID-19 was quite a stressful situation with severe anxiety. About what, how we're going to do this. And we started the communication with the infection control and the hospital administration about how to deal with this, because this was the first time to start dealing with a proven case to do to that needs exploration. So in parallel, we started doing the consultation with the interventional radiology to see if we can drain this, and the ultrasound repeatedly it was showing that there is no actual sizable collection to have a drain inserted in, and that gave us some time to discuss the intervention for the COVID-19. And then finally they decided to put a pigtail in the lower right side of the abdomen, and it was properly inserted in the retroperitoneum with quite a range of good amount. And then this volume started to decline with time. The patient received the transfer to the isolation unit for COVID patients in the same pediatric hospital. The patient was vitally stable with mild fluctuation that we are going to talk about as regard the toxic features. There was no fever, actually improved general condition very much, and the appetite was regained, and the child was almost like normal after the drainage, which is expected after any drainage. There has been a decline in the output, which was made us very enthusiastic about that. And the follow-up for the COVID-19 also decreased, with the follow-up of the D-dimer down to 3,500. There has been still, in the follow-up ultrasound, turbid collection, which is still very small, a 2 centimeter, cubic centimeter. So we still kept on doing that. And then we had a very good discussion through the web meetings with the whole department. And then we were still discussing, shall we intervene because this is a duodenal injury? And so we were still controversial about whether the leakage is still ongoing or not. Important part of that the fever was a bit fluctuating with most of the daytime, the 24 hours, most of them, he was afebrile, but he had few attacks of fever every day. In the isolation unit, there has been a very difficult time going in to check him for the clinical rounds every day because they have to go through the PPE. So we couldn't see him like in the usual ward in the department where we can see him every 10 minutes. So that was very low. And the attendance also of the nursing staff was not really very easy, also because of the PPE's repeated replacements. So the follow-up for this vital data was mainly obtained only a few times a day. There has been a suggestion that we check for the ongoing leakage. So we had whether to do it with the contrast swallow or methylene blue, and then we decided not to transfer him down from the isolation room to the radiology department. So we gave him the methylene blue orally, and the methylene blue was draining right ahead with very short transit time through the pigtail drain. So we had the absolute confirmation that there is an ongoing leakage, and we made the decision to go for exploration. And that was still very stressful because we were still very early about how threatening is it to operate on COVID-19. How are we going to do that afterwards? How are we going to follow up afterwards? And if he's having a fever afterwards, is it because of the transperitoneal soiling or because of the COVID-19? So there has been a lot of stress. The infection control were very helpful. They arranged because we had the other hospital with which is fully equipped for COVID-19 patients with the OR and ICU was full. So we had to arrange to move our OR to a COVID-19 session. And the infection control supported us with that, with a lot of PPEs and a lot of sterilization while transferring the patient from the isolation unit to the OR and backwards. And we did the exploration on day 7 of admission, which makes it the day 10 of trauma. We went through midline longitudinal incision transperitoneal approach with a PPE, which is really very tough. I mean, we had to adapt with three masks and a lot of gowns, several gowns. So we had to check for ourselves before we started. It took us about 5 to 10 minutes to check that the sweating is normal and is not because of any cardiac insufficiency or respiratory insufficiency. Retroperitoneal pus was found, and this was really difficult. We had to have to discuss this a bit. The peritoneal cavity was absolutely clean and clear, but we found that the mesentery shows some areas of weakening and pus pointing. One of them was very close to the transverse colon mesentery, to the right side of the DJ, and the other one was at the level at the junction of the ileocecal junction, and this was very weak. And then during the examination, it just burst up with a flow of pus through it. We did not know; we were not very sure at the first whether this is an opening in the mesentery itself or is it continuous with the terminal ileum. So we insinuated it with the finger. And then we realized that this is going through the mesentery to the retroperitoneum. The lateral colonic attachments, peritoneal attachments, were very thick, very, very thick, that we could not differentiate it with the colonic wall. Actually, the colonic wall might have been even thinner. So we used the finger guidance through the retroperitoneal insinuation from the ileocecal junction, and then we started incising the lateral attachments of the colon. Accessing the retroperitoneum, when we did the whole colonic cauterization and arrived to the peritoneum, also there has been attachment for the gallbladder very close to the duodenum and the colon at that level. So we did the dissection. That was not really very difficult. And then we found that there has been a cavity around the duodenum, and the duodenum perforation was very obvious, was directly ahead, very obvious. While when the colon was just reflected, the duodenum perforation was in the right part, in the second part, and we can see it here. It's over here, and this is actually the mucosal perforation. And if we look at here, this is the perforation here in the mucosa, but also the seromuscular or the muscular, because this is the retroperitoneal, is actually much, much bigger than that. You can see here is the mucosal perforation, all of this. This is the magnified part. And here is the edge of the muscle. So this is all a part of the mucosa outside part. So we closed the mucosa at first. And then, this is the poll. What would you like to do? Primary repair with omental patch, primary repair with duodenal exclusion, primary repair plus gastrogenostomy, duodenogenostomy for the perforation. Wow. Primary repair with the omental patch, 60%, and primary repair with gastrogenostomy for 30%. Primary repair only for 5%, and primary repair with the duodenal exclusion, 4%. Duodenogenostomy, another 4%. Okay, excellent. So the two main are primary repair with omental patch and primary repair with gastrogenostomy. Okay, then what we did, we've described the operative details. The third part of the duodenum was very difficult to with the hole of adhesions, because that was very close to the mesenteric vessels. So we're very cautious about that. Actually, Nader was laughing now, because actually when we were mobilizing the duodenum at first, we found that there was some bleeding. And then we realized that it wasn't the duodenum. It was actually the inferior vena cava. Because of the edema at that place, we were dissecting the IVC as well. Fortunately enough, we did not breach it, but they were just small tributaries probably or something like that. So it just stopped away, and then we managed with the edema. So it was really that was actually one more stressful situation more than the COVID-19. We did the primary repair for the duodenal perforation. For the mucosa, two layers, and then we've had to go, because the muscle layer was actually far away from each other, so we had an omental patch, and it was covering the whole mucosa, also to the sides of the perforation. Until it's attached to, yes, we see here, now we don't see any, this is the omentum, it's rolled backward here, and then we attached it to the muscle layer on both sides, here and the other side. So now we're having no raw surface, no mucosa only layer. Here is the IVC, if you see this. Okay, so before we move to this one, we were dissecting this one. Okay. Then two drains were inserted, one at the paraduodenal space and one in the left pelvic area with fixation of the pigtail at its place. But we also did the gastrogenostomy. We thought of the gastrogenostomy as a drainage for the stomach. And actually, we should have had a poll here which is the one done, whether we should do the exclusion for the duodenum or not. Actually, it's still controversial with a lot of opinions about whether to do this exclusion or not. We did the gastrogenostomy. We are still concerned about if he gets a stomal ulcer or not, because we didn't do a vagotomy, but we'll follow him up. And the post-operative was really fluctuating at the first, because at the start, because the fever ups and downs were not really easily controllable or easily monitorable because of being still in the COVID ward. This is really something to note. the stress of the COVID-19 patients at the time was quite not that high, but the ward for the COVID-19 was full, and the nursing staff had to go with PPE several times a day, and the residents had to go 2 times a day. Still, if you have a fever, you cannot check it like after receiving an antipyretic and then re-getting it back, because only the mother was sitting beside the child, so there was, so we had to wait like 4 hours or something like that backwards. The patient went on smoothly. The outcomes from the drains was negligible. The follow-up for the COVID-19 until being negative was a happy news, and then we got him down to the pediatric surgery ICU. Then now we can have a full monitoring, which was really very different than when we have it like faxes or on telegrams. The feeding started on day 8, post-operative with clear fluids, then soft diet. And we had a contrast follow through on day 10, no leakage, drains removed, and the patient was discharged home happily almost after 2 weeks of the procedure, which is almost Dr. Muhammad, 24 hours. Yes, please.
Thank you very much. And please check the chat, because many of our experts and colleagues want to say some comments.
Yes, yes. Very important.
Dr. Muhammad, please, Osama Nagar, would you mind to summarize for us in points, what are the lessons we had learned from this case?
Okay, lessons first, air in the seat, blunt abdominal trauma with instability of the vital data, even for the toxic features like fever or tachycardia or increasing leukocytic count, then we have to proceed to the CT scan with double contrast, IV and oral contrast.
Do you think that even patients with handlebar injury and after 3 days and still having abdominal symptoms, he does deserve CT scan even if you don't have air in this area? Because here you have an isolated duodenal injury, but you can have as well duodenal bile ducts and pancreatic injuries, which is very common and very worried in this situation.
Exactly.
So first, air in the
retro. Air is pathognomonic. Air in the retroperitoneum is pathognomonic of duodenal injury. Yes. That's one of the lessons learned.
Not,
yes, from
not something is not something to go without consideration.
Yes, this is the most important. This is the most important pathognomonic sign for duodenal perforation is the retroperitoneal free air, which was very, very clear in the CT. And,
okay. Second thing.
Excuse me.
Second lesson. You think we learned from this one?
Duodenal injury cannot go conservatively. This has been stated clearly in almost all of the literature. And it has been proven again in this case. We've been worried and we were buying time because of the COVID-19 just to avoid things. But still, surgery for duodenal injury is the main task, except for duodenal hematoma, of course. Duodenal injury, duodenal perforation is surgery.
If you don't mind, Dr. Muhammad, I see Dr. Yes. Ahmed raising his hands. So
please
unmute him and let him discuss.
Yes. With Dr. Please, yes, unmute to Dr.
Dr. Saada. Ahmed
and yes.
Okay, sir.
Unmute now? Yes.
Assalamu alaikum.
Alaikum assalam, Dr. Ahmed Bik.
Ya basha, ana yani fi ghayat al-ajab wal-taqdir لجرأتكم ان انتوا تفتحوا العيان ده.
ساتر ربك يا بيه.
والله يعني عايز اقول ايه التقاعس الجامد ده. يعني سبحان الله يعني صراحة شكرا جزيلا لكم على الجرأة وربنا يجعله في ميزان حسناتكم. دي
حاجة. ربنا يبارك في حضرتك خليك.
جدا ان انا ابقى قاعد مستريح كده وناقش تعملوا ايه. في الظروف اللي انتوا كنتوا فيها. Whatever you did is good. طيب في الظروف دي كان ان انا اصبر على الكونزرفاتيف تريتمنت فور لونجر تايم خصوصا ان العيان نوت ديتيريوريتد، هل ممكن اكستند الاوبزرفيشن فور 3 ويكس مثلا؟ دي حاجه. الحاجه الثانيه لما يبقى عندي سوس ابسس اتعودنا ان احنا نعمل له درينج من الانجوينر ريجن، ايه الفيزيبيليتي بتاعت الموضوع ده او ان انا احط حتى البيج تيل من نفس المكان ده؟
هم عملوا كده فعلا، هم داخلين بالبيج تيل من تحت كده فعلا زي ما عليكم بتقول.
وشكرا جزيلا لحضراتكم طبعا.
ربنا يحفظك خليك دكتور احمد بيه. يس هو they inserted the pig tail actually from low down there and it was really good that the controversy about continuing on the conservative management with the drainage with the pig tail was actually because of we were afraid about the mild fluctuation there. We had a rising total leukocytic count and that was really an alarming sign. We were very afraid because of the retroperitoneal infection that might worsen without notice, because this is different than the transperitoneal infection where we get a lot of signs, but the retroperitoneal sometimes may be masked for quite a long time. So the rising TLC was what pushed us to the decision of going on to surgical exploration.
Dr. Samal Halabi has some comments.
Okay, I would like to add something, you know, but, to clarify something. As we had seen, in fact, in cases of duodenal injury, if you have not type 1, which is a duodenal hematoma, because there is one question in the chat about duodenal hematoma. Duodenal hematoma treatment is conservative. If not responding, as well, you can do drainage for this hematoma. But in case of duodenal perforations, you have to intervene. The problem is, as long as you delay the surgery, you will have what we had in this case. You looked at the operative field, a busted there, very difficult to reach to the site of the injury, as well as we are lucky, and the patient is lucky, because duodenal closure here in the midst of these infections will not be possible and will not be easy. And the patients will deteriorate and the patients will have duodenal fistula, a very high output fistula. He is a COVID-19 as well, so we may not be able to maintain and support him. So if you suspecting duodenal injury as well, you have, after suspecting it by the gas or air in the retroperitoneum, there is another questions in the chat about why oral contrast. Oral contrast is essential because this is important to give you two pieces of information. First, where is the site of the duodenal injury? Number two, what is the extent of the duodenal injury? Because actually, the extent of surgery and complexity of management will depend on these two pieces of information. The site of the duodenal injury and the extent of the duodenal injury. So doing an oral contrast, either with a CT scan or without CT scan, is an essential step, is an essential investigation in a case of duodenal injury, because it can give you preoperatively a mind map about what are you going to do, what the extent of complexity of surgery that you may be in need. So very essential to have this information to plan your surgery.
Saada, kindly open the mic for Dr. Professor Dr. Assam Al-Halabi, please. He has some comments. Yes.
Dr. Assam Ghi. Dr. Sawaf سأل عن الجيجنال patch. Actually, we're thinking of that as well. But because it's on the right side of the second part, the jejunum would have been going across and kinked by the colon when it gets back to its site. So we prefer to do it with the omentum, because the omentum will not be harmed with the kink rather than the jejunum if it gets kinked and observed.
شكرا طبعا معنا. شكرا دكتور نادر. شكرا لحضرتك. شكرا دكتور محمد. شكرا أسامة. شكرا كل الجروب الجميلة ديت والديسكشن الـ is going discussion. I would like to start with the standard management of perforated duodenal trauma, the classic, for the classic teaching is exploration. I know that, and we have to stress on that. But in this particular situation, if you have a duodenal injury, and if you have already drained, and you started to give some the methylene blow test, and you started to have a free drainage, that means the drain which is inserted is draining effectively, and the especially if the abdomen is not that rigid and the peritonitis, how I not to continue? People say, no, if there is a perforation, there is no rule for percutaneous, this conservative. This is not a conservative. This is, you have a controlled percutaneous drainage. I just would like to say a case for Dr. Hisham Muhammad Al-Haya. There was a case of duodenal trauma recently from almost 1 year now. And it, the patient was operated twice, and it was a mega perforation every time. And was, and then it has been the second time there was not being everything they putting together was again disrupting, and they believe that the patient is not there has no chance, and with drainage and TBN for almost 6 weeks, it closed. Even it was the perforation was very significant. So this might be again against the standard guidelines. But in some situation, I believe in such a case, I would consider seriously that option in the management of such a case. Needless to say, you have been to be congratulated, all of you, all the staff, all the help you have also get it from all the healthcare provider around you, and everybody has to be congratulated for the management of this difficult case in this difficult situation. Thank you, Muhammad.
Thank you, Abi. Thank you, Abi. Actually, I was pro the same thing, but Sohna, we got very, very fearful about rising total electricity count and if there is an ongoing fasciitis or retroperitoneal infection. So that's what we had the discussion about, and then we decided to intervene. But yes, of course. Yeah, I mean, if you
don't mind, yes. Dr. Assam, you stayed 6 weeks, TBN,
6 weeks,
mm-hmm. 6 weeks, yes. High, yes, output fistula, 6 weeks, complications, and even you don't know the sequelae, duodenal strictures, pile duct strictures, whatever. What I mean is that there is no room for duodenal conservative treatments. The thing is that either you are going to do primary repair for the duodenum with adjuncts, I mean pyloric exclusions, gastrogenostomy, duodenal diverticulizations, three tubes, duodenostomies, all these what we call primary repair with adjuncts, or up to the situation if this was a complete injury and complete transections of the second part of the duodenum near the bile duct and pancreatic ducts, you may reach to the Whibble operation. What I mean that...
ارتحت يا سعدة. الدكتور حتى وصله كمان كان بيسأل هو الدكتور سعدة عن الكومبليت ترانسكشن. فربنا يكفينا الشر والسوء كفاية. خدنا نصيبنا.
Yeah, that's why I'm stressing the important thing. Time is crucial. As long as you say that this is a controlled fistula, you have some bile coming out, but you are not sure that this bile is not insinuating itself in the retroperitoneum. You cannot judge this. So if you have a revealed fistula, which even of going to be decreasing in amount, this may not be a good sign. It may be an ominous sign. What I mean is doing surgery with infections, with increased necrosis, with increased pus in the operative fields makes the operation more complex and the results is not good. So as soon as possible, you have to interfere with these cases. Choice between primary repair and adjuncts, as I call it, whatever, pyloric exclusion, gastrogenostomy, whatever, this is something else we can discuss. But yeah, what we want to stress is time is important, size and site of the perforation of the duodenum is very crucial, because this will change your plan of management completely. So please, this is a message that I want to reach the people. In this case, of course, we go here and there because of the COVID 19 problems, and we don't know what to do. Yes. What are the observations that he will have? That's what makes us somewhat reluctant in taking the decision immediately. I would like to comment on the methylene blue. This was the idea of Dr. Ahmed Medhat, actually. And because we were reluctant, this is Dr. Ahmed Medhat's idea, and it was brilliant, actually, because we were reluctant. If this bile that is coming because of extra hepatic bile duct injury and not duodenal injury, although, as we said, the presence of air is very ominous sign. So because we cannot take the patient to the radiology suite, we give him this vessel in blue, and now we have a duodenal open, so we have to close it.
And just to put things in harmony, I would say, Dr. Usama, lo samahti li, Dr. Muhammad, I would say for that patient in particular, I'm not saying to start to cancel the option of surgical intervention. I'm just saying if you do contrast study, oral contrast study, and the majority of the dye is passing to the fourth part of duodenum, to jejunum, and so on. And some part of the dye is going through outside, leaking outside, and this retroperitoneum. And this is the part that leaks outside in the retroperitoneum is drained efficiently by the already existing drain. And you follow up this patient, this is might be an indication for just to continue percutaneous drainage. Because as you know, Christian, how many of us go through these patients, and at the beginning, during starting laparotomy, it's not that bad. You have some retroperitoneal hematoma, and once we started to dig around, you will have the very friable tissue, and the injury site is becomes more and more increased, and the lacerations becomes very wide, which was a little bit. This is the same concept with some. Not the same analogy like splenic injury. So when you started to do any manipulation, you might induce splenectomy. It's not the same analogy, but I would say some of these cases and with controlled external drainage, with repeated ultrasound, there is no increase in collection, and with follow up for the vital signs and the labs, I would say it might be there is a rule. This is my opinion, but
we have. Yes, Dr. Assam.
Yes.
Yeah, we have to prove it by data, Dr. Assam, because we go and revise all the literature. This is our way always, is to try to expand our knowledge for every case, especially these rare cases. And actually, there is no support for doing a conservative treatment for duodenal injury. In contrary, actually, that small duodenal perforations, that is not complete and partial, the primary bear success rate is higher than the big one and the one that is not going through the jejunum. And so this is what I want to stress about. If we have cases like this, we have to find support from the literature. So if you have data in the literature that support this, this will be very nice. And of course, not going into these patients is better options. But what I am afraid of is that we may lose the patients because of the sepsis and infection sequelae that these patients may have.
Just to set it up, the number of cases already recorded in literature worldwide is not really very high. I mean, we've been revising even the biggest centers' experiences. They are not really very high. So the agreed upon management now is still surgical intervention. Yet we should agree that there can be a trials for those. We were unlucky here because the patient did not get cured with just the drainage. Maybe he did not have enough time. Maybe if we waited more, maybe we were more afraid to wait for more than that. But still, yes, why not? We should maybe we can try it like an experimental study first to induce an injury, and then we start.
Please, no? You should not experiment. Patients will die.
You will do experimental.
When I'm saying experimental, I am clear about animals. Experimental, Dr. Osama B. We have to induce the duodenal injury in an animal model, and then we decide that if it succeeds, we can do that. Because actually, the mortality, even in surgical exploration, is not low.
It's a very nice idea for.
With surgical exploration is not low, especially after the first 24 hours.
It's a very nice idea for a thesis in Masri, this new research center that we're going to. I think we need to move your Sam, otherwise we'll not be able to. Thank you very much, Debeki and Nader and Ahmed Musa for actually you did it was a strong challenge. We were all afraid that you might catch. COVID-19 and alhamdulillah that everything went and actually it was very courageous from you to do that, especially it was in the early days of COVID when we did not understand anything. Thank you very much.
Thank you.